This show is produced by the Hartman Media Company. For more information and links to all our great podcasts, visit hartmanmedia.com.
Welcome to The Commercial Investing Show, where we analyze, explain, and exploit the opportunities presented in today's commercial property marketplace. If you're interested in apartments, mobile home parks, self-storage facilities, and other income property, you've come to the right place. We'll explore what's hot and what's not in markets nationwide in the relentless pursuit of return on investment. Here's your host, Jason Hartman.
Today, we're going to have our continuing discussion with Bridger Pennington interviewing me. We'll get to that in a moment. But first, I want to talk to you about the most basic rule of economics, supply and demand, but specifically demand, actually more specifically, shadow demand, a very important consideration when thinking about the housing market and predicting where the housing market is going. So let's talk about shadow demand. What is that? Shadow demand represents demand that is out there, but it is not yet seen in the marketplace. During the Great Recession, we heard a lot about the housing market and shadow supply, this inventory that hadn't yet hit the market. But now we are facing a different situation. We have very low supply, and we have a lot of demand that has yet to hit the market. So I want to do a brief analysis on this, and then we'll get to our interview today. So if you look at the number of adults between the ages of 18 and 34, we've got about 68 million of these people in the United States. And this is according to Wikipedia, about 120 million adults that are 25 to 54 years old. Okay, so these represent two big demographic cohorts for home buying trends, not really the younger than 25 group. We're going to divide these up even more. Let's look at the next slide. So here we see an estimated share of young adults living at home with their parents. They have not yet moved out. They have not yet formed their own household. So we've got the 18 to 24 year old cohort, and we don't have to think too much about them. They're mostly in college or they're living at home. They're just starting out. They're not going to buy a house yet. They're not even probably going to rent a house yet in many cases. I mean, look at the numbers of them, right? For the last 3 years, we see this number hovering around 55 to 58% of adult Americans, 18 to 24 year old, living at home. And interestingly, we saw this number increase during the pandemic, probably because they kicked them out of the dorm rooms, they kicked them out of college, and they came home to live with their parents during the lockdown periods. Okay, forget about this demographic, not important in terms of housing demand or household formation yet. They will be, but we'll talk about them on a much later show in the future. What we should focus on, though, is the demographic age 25 to 34. These are definitely people that should be out on their own renting a house, if not buying a house, but at least renting a house. So about 16% of adult Americans in this age cohort are still living at home. This represents shadow demand that we have not seen hit the rental market or the home buying market. So what does that really mean? Well, we've got about, what, 68 million of them, right? Let's look at that. 16% equates to about 11 million people, to be exact, 10,880,000 people. Now, think about this in reference to the amount of inventory in terms of housing supply there is on the market now. The for sale supply in the United States is about what? You know the numbers. Come on, we've been talking about them all the time. You know, let's go with about 565,000, about half of what most people say it should be to be in a quote unquote normal market, right? The inventory is half. Now, We've been hearing about this shadow supply from the gloomers who have been wrong, 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 wrong over and over again, right? Everybody from Peter Schiff on to all the rest of them. And, you know, he doesn't really focus on the housing market too much, but a doomer much the same, right? As Robert Kiyosaki has said, he's predicted 19 out of the last two recessions. I love that. Okay, so all of the gloomers talk about this shadow supply. All these people that are supposed to dump their homes on the market, right? But we have explored ad nauseum why that's just not happening. And they've been predicting this for many, many years, folks. They've been wrong for a long time, not just recently, a long, long time. Remember, I've been doing this for 20 years, just working with investors. So, you know, with all that experience, I've heard thousands and thousands, maybe tens of thousands of people with all of their opinions and their reasons why this and that is going to happen. So a lot of experience there, and they have just been wrong over and over again. Okay, so we've got these 11 million people that represent shadow demand for the rental market and the home buying market. And then we've got the folks, especially recently, that have talked about the short-term rental market and the Airbnb market, and how all of these folks are going to be dumping their houses on the market. And certainly some of them have, no question about that, but it has been a very low number, and it never happens all at once. So we definitely have not seen the threat of shadow supply hit the housing market, but we definitely, no question, have a lot of shadow demand. Remember, in 2010, I was saying that the demographics coming at the rental housing market are nothing short of phenomenal. And I renewed that prediction for another 10 years in 2020. So we'll see how it all turns out. But 11 million people are ultimately, the vast majority of them at least, of course, you probably saw the movie Failure to Launch. We definitely have some of that in society, no question about it. But by and large, most of these people, look, they're going to move out, they're going to form their own household, right? So think of the amount of shadow demand in reference to the amount of supply that is available on the market. A very big distinction. So let's take a look at this article. This is from Housing Wire, and it talks about predicting what's going to happen next year in terms of the housing market, right? Here's what you can expect from the housing market next year. Home prices will remain firm and grow in most markets. That's what they're saying. So on this first part of the article, they're sort of talking about the typical stuff, nothing too surprising there. But on this next part that I'm showing you, a couple of comments and segments that are interesting here. Number one, consumers will reset their expectations. And as rates move lower, there will be both more buyers and more sellers in the market. Obviously, this means increased transaction volume, which is great news for all of the people that have been complaining that depend on transaction volume. All the real estate brokers, the real estate agents, the escrow people, the title people, the lenders, the settlement attorneys, the home warranty companies, and so much home improvement, furniture companies, appliance companies, you know, contractors, all of these people, when they buy a home, when they transact, they spend money. And that's why this segment of the economy is so critically important to the government, because they know that propping up the housing market, doing whatever it takes, is absolutely necessary because it feeds into so many other segments of the economy. Now, remember, I told you this over 2 years ago. I told you that when the market shifts, we would see a lot of doom and gloom news, and people would have to face affordability problems. And of course, that all came true. But I also told you that people would ultimately reset their expectations. And that is now coming true. That's taken a while. It always takes a while for people to adjust their psychology and to kind of reset their expectations and just decide, look, we have what we have. We're going to buy what we can buy. We got to move on with our lives. And, you know, even if we don't get that super cheap mortgage that everybody got a couple of years ago, even if the house is more expensive than it was a couple of years ago, we got to just move on. Okay. You know, it's not the good old days anymore. It is what it is. And life goes on. And so people are doing that, no question about it, and they will continue to do it. They always do. I've seen the cycle happen so many times in my career, and you see it in other parts of the economy and other markets as well, not just housing. Now, here's a couple more things from the article. However, the desire for home ownership is very strong. The underlying demographic fundamentals indicate strong demand and low inventory in 2024 and through the rest of the decade. Remember, we just talked about the shadow demand. That's only one major factor boding well for the housing market and increased demand. The oldest millennials are now in their early 40s, but the age of a first-time buyer, 36, is the highest on record, and home ownership rates in this cohort are significantly lower than prior generations. If millennials were homeowners at the same rate as Gen Xers, that's my generation, or young baby boomers were at the same age, there would be 740,000 more homeowners in the United States. Now, that would obviously eat up all the supply of housing inventory, and we would have a deficit of about 200,000 homes, right? You see the shadow demand, and then this different interpretation showing about how many more homeowners there would be, right? So you just can tell there's so much evidence showing this, and really so little evidence showing the other side of the argument. And listen, if the other side of the argument were the right side of the argument, that's what we'd be talking about. We're just going by the, you know, like they said on that old, what's that old show, Dragnet, where the famous detective would say, just the facts, ma'am. You know, yeah, I'm definitely dating myself. Listen, that was before my time, but I did see reruns of it. Just the facts, ma'am. These are the facts, right? That is a significant amount of pent-up demand, some of which is waiting for a drop in rates and more inventory because inventory is so low next year. Okay, now, the last part. While inventory will increase somewhat next year, supply will still be low, largely due to the other big demographic cohort affecting the market. Boomers, the baby boomers, right? Boomers are staying in their homes longer. Sub 3% mortgage rates and a lack of homes to downsize into because there's no choices for them, and they have the lock-in effect of the super low rates. Two big factors keeping them in their homes, making them unwilling to sell, and that's contributed, right? Okay, so last thing on this article, and then I'm highlighting this entire section here, right? These demographic factors are the primary reason home prices will remain firm and will grow in most markets in 2024. There are potential wild cards to consider. Another strain of coronavirus is always a threat lurking in the corner. Geopolitical risk and economic recession could amplify consumer anxiety and lead to less home buying and less selling activity. And while presidential elections do not tend to have an outsized impact on the housing market in most cycles, it could be a different story this year if further deterioration in the political landscape. I don't even really know what that means. Does it mean more division? So the interesting thing about the last paragraph with the wild cards is that if these things happen, here's one of the things that the gloomers never say, right? Or they never just realize because they just aren't thinking this stuff through. We have a centrally planned economy, and there's always a reaction. You know, even Ken McElroy, right? He mentioned this to me, you know, when during COVID a couple of years ago, when it first hit, he was predicting, oh, it's the end of the world. This year's over. Forget it, right? And a lot of people contacted me about his videos on that topic, right? And he said to me later, he said, what I didn't realize is the Fed's reaction to the COVID crisis, right? That they lowered rates so much. Look, just like they did after 9/11, just like they did during the Great Recession, just like they always do, they always react, they always do some kind of stimulus, right? So if any of these terrible things happen, another strain of corona is out there, right? Or we have more geopolitical problems, right? More wars, more problems, right? They will react to this. You can be confident because they need to keep the housing market going. Okay, so let's get to our continuing discussion with Bridger Pennington. Here we go. You have to look at inventory on a per household basis. Really.
With what's your thoughts on this, you know, inventory shortage based on millennials or even Gen Z not purchasing homes as much or later in life? This would be maybe some people say, well, yeah, if this was all boomers, yeah, they'd be buying at 30 years old. But a lot of millennials and Gen Zs are saying, I'm okay to rent. Yeah. I'm okay to not own a home. What's your thoughts on that trend that's been happening the last decade?
I think that that has been true, but it is not so true anymore. Millennials really are finally growing up and moving into the housing market in a big, big way. So, you know, again, there's that 6-year lag, right? Where millennials are 6 years behind schedule vis-a-vis baby boomers. I mean, listen, millennials are not kids anymore. The oldest millennial is what, 43 years old now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
These are not kids. Okay. You know, now we have to talk about Gen Z. Okay. We have to talk about the Zoomers, not the millennials anymore, right? You know, that was
more,
true.
More millennials coming in now buying homes just later. They're just doing it later.
Absolutely. Okay. They are definitely moving into the housing market. Okay. So just look at this again. Okay. Here's another way to look at it. Here's the inventory, and we have urgently low inventory. The inventory needs to be above this level. If you look at 2019, okay, any of these years, 2018, 2017, right? Those were not bad markets. They were very strong markets. I mean, listen, one of my main companies sells real estate. So we're on the front lines. I mean, we help investors buy properties nationwide and build their portfolios. Like, we have one client that's got about 200 doors through us now. Okay, so this is what we do. We're not talking theory. I live this every day. See it. Our investment counselors are talking to clients. I'm talking to clients, they are buying properties, and they're struggling to find good properties to buy. It's still a low inventory market. Yes, admittedly, it's not as low as it was during the crazy COVID era, but it's still historically low. Okay,
that's well, this helps paint a better picture too of why median home prices, you had that slide earlier, have not fallen.
Yeah.
With the rate that interest rates have gone up. Now, maybe it's a lagging indicator. Maybe, you know, interest rates take time to trickle down through an economy. But at least for me,
well,
I was
God
like,
knows
man,
we've had a year of high interest rates now. Okay?
Yeah.
So,
yeah, we've had it, you know, and I'm like, well, house prices should start coming down. They should be coming down. They're coming because just affordability has gone just on its head. But if you look at this chart, you go, oh, well, maybe it's because inventory is just still so drastically low.
There's just nothing to buy. Yeah. That's the problem. I heard an interesting CNBC interview the other day, and these leaps in logic that people make are really scary. Okay. The expert on CNBC was saying that housing is due for a correction. And he says, here's his theory. The Fed is going to pivot, and I agree with him. The Fed is going to pivot. Nobody knows exactly when, not even Jerome Powell, but the Fed will pivot and they'll start reducing rates. I think ultimately, Bridger, if I had to guess, although interest rates are impossible to predict, okay, I would think that rates are going to settle somewhere in the fives for mortgage rates. Okay. Yeah. And that means non-owner occupied mortgage rates will be in the sixes. And that's about where we're going to have as the sort of the new normal. Okay. Ultimately. But the Fed hasn't pivoted yet, and they're probably a ways away from pivoting. But here's his theory. When the Fed pivots, people will finally sell their houses because the delta between the rate they have and the rate they can get on a new house won't be so much. So they'll have an incentive to sell. That theory is true. The problem is what he didn't tell you. And what he didn't tell you is when the Fed pivots and we see mortgage rates decline that much, we're going to see housing affordability go way up. And it's going to light the market on fire again. If you lower interest rates in a no inventory market, you're going to get massive demand for such limited supply. So, and you know, these theories from these experts just don't make sense. They don't really look at the whole picture. So what we are in right now is we are in a new home market, a new construction market, because real estate developers, home builders do not have the lock-in effect. When they build houses, they need to sell them. They don't have 30-year debt at super cheap rates, right? Yeah. So if we look at new single-family homes as a share of the overall market, we see here is where they were in the 80s, 90s, you know, 2000s. And then here was the bottom coming out of the Great Recession where just everybody stopped building. Okay, then we climbed back out of it, and now we see new homes, new construction, holding about a third of the overall market, which is insane. Usually,
that
number is
about the average before was what 10 to 20%, and that
10 to 13%,
dropped to 5%, and then now up to about 35%.
So the only market is the new home market because the resale sellers won't sell; they just aren't putting their houses on the market in any real way. Here's a good way to look at it. Everybody listening, close your eyes for a minute, and I want you to picture in your mind your kitchen sink. Picture your kitchen sink, Okay. And now I want you to assume that your sink has the drain, the stopper's in the drain, and it's about 35% full of water. And the faucet is on, but it's a trickle. And you didn't put the stopper in quite right, so some water is draining out. Here's what's happening. That describes the housing market. The faucet represents the new properties coming up for sale, and it's just trickling. There's a little bit coming on the market, but not very much. The faucet would be on full blast if people didn't have these cheap mortgages they won't give up, okay? But the faucet is trickling. The sink is about one third full. Let's assume that a normal market, not a bad market, just a normal market, is a full sink. Now, if it were a really bad market, a buyer's market, the sink would be overflowing with inventory, right? And the drain is a little bit clogged because before the drain was totally open and everything that would come on the market was getting purchased left and right. Now we see that the drain has like a 20% clog because there is less demand. The higher interest rates have definitely hurt demand and there's less activity, less sales activity because of this. So that's where we are in the market. The sink metaphor helps people really understand what's going on, I think.
Interesting, yeah. So you're not, you know, people have been looking at days on market or these properties aren't selling, at least for the current prices. And a lot of there's total transactions have, at least I've heard from my real estate friends, have dropped significantly.
Oh, they have.
Yeah. Over the last year. But you're saying it's still not as great as what people are panicking about.
Well, let's examine that. Let's unpack that a bit. Okay. Total transactions, first of all. The reason total transactions are down is, you know, most people just think it's demand destruction caused by higher interest rates and lower affordability. And that's somewhat true. But mostly the reason sales activity is down is because there's a lack of inventory. If there was more inventory, you could have more sales. I mean, look, if you own a shoe store and you sell shoes and you only have 30% of your normal selection and 70% or 65% of the shoe racks are empty and have no shoes on them, you're not going to sell as many shoes.
Yeah.
You need more inventory to sell more.
But then you're also seeing days on market though. So those shoes are sitting on the shelves for longer and longer.
Not very long at a historical level.
I haven't seen the recent averages.
I mean, look, days on market has increased. No one would deny that, but it's compared to what? I mean, compared to 2 years ago, of course it's increased. I mean, the cost of money has tripled. Mortgage payments are higher than they were, dramatically higher. So there's no question that housing affordability has taken a hit. Now, listen, all of the people with the predictions of doom will be right someday. There's no question there will be a correction. Okay. I want everybody to hear me say that. Nothing yeah. lasts forever. I'm just saying this is where we are today. And we are not at that point yet. Someday we will be there.
Yeah, I love it. This is awesome, Jason. Now, just for time's sake, I'm going to switch gears for a little bit. I want to talk about a few other things. I want to talk about, well, and this all in relation to banks. Right now, we've had an inverted yield curve over a year. The banking model does not work with an inverted yield curve. And
that's why I think the pivot is required. Yeah.
Sorry, say it again.
That's why I think the Fed has to pivot because they're going to kill more banks. We're going to have more banks breaking.
So yeah, and you have this with, I mean, mortgages is a massive product for banks. Like yep. They sell and package and resell. If we are seeing it, maybe whether it's a housing inventory or shortage, all the metrics you just talked about, but I'm at least from where I sit, it looks like this is stretching banks. Additionally, they bought bonds that are now very much undervalued from what the market price they purchased them. They're just not marking them market to market. How does this, what you just told us all about single family real estate, dovetailing with inverted yield curve with bonds decreasing value, do you foresee a banking crash or crisis coming soon?
Yeah, it's a great question. And first of all, I want to make the disclaimer, I'm not a banking expert. There are people who spend their entire careers studying banks and they still can't figure it out. Okay. Mm-hmm. But from my layperson's point of view, let's just talk about SVB or Silicon Valley Bank. Okay. Yeah. The major reason, I mean, there are multiple reasons. Okay. But the major thing that hurt Silicon Valley Bank is they had these hold to maturity bonds that they purchased when those rates were very low and those rates went up and the value of them went down. It's just what you described a moment ago and what we talked about earlier. So that dramatically hurt them. And then Zero Hedge published this chart and it had a list of all the big banks and it had the percentage of hold to maturity assets they owned. But what it didn't tell you was more important than what it did tell you. Okay. And what it didn't tell you is the rate on those hold to maturity assets, the rate that bank was you know, holding the mat, which wasn't necessarily as low as Silicon Valley banks. So those assets weren't underwater like theirs. And it didn't tell you the maturity dates, which usually are staggered and laddered. So they're all different. So you just have to like peel the layers of the onion back. But yeah. Overall, I think your question is a great one. And I think it speaks to the reality that the Fed will have no choice but to pivot because more things will break. And one of the big things that could break is the banking system. Okay. And also, we've got to remember the government is a debtor. Okay. And the government pays its debts at higher interest rates the longer this goes on because they have to make T-bills competitive with the overall market. So they have an incentive to see lower rates ultimately. So there is so much going in favor of lower rates and a Fed pivot. And there's one thing going against it, and that is inflation. Okay.
Yeah.
And I say what will always happen is the elite class will always sell out the poor and the middle class and let them suffer the inflation burden while they take advantage of what's called the Cantillon effect, which is an economist from like 250 years ago who talked about how the people closest to the money benefit the most. And the upper middle class and the rich and the elite class, they all benefit from the money printer. So they'll let inflation run. That'll be, you know, they're going to try to stave it off a bit, and they have done, you know, a reasonable job of that. But you know, it's not going to last.
Interesting
forever.
on the bank side of thing. Yeah, I've talked to a number of funds that we work with. There was a big REIT last week that threw. I mean, there was a 18 property portfolio. They just threw the keys to the bank. They said we're good. We don't want them anywhere. They couldn't get values on them. I'm curious to see if a lot of people have been saying the commercial real estate space is going to blow up because work from home in conjunction with higher interest rates, a lot of these companies aren't paying anymore. I guess we will see again with all these things with banks. I've been trying to, again, like you said, though, it is hard to study banks and find out what is going on because banks are just so, because I've been trying to study and figure out how to like underwrite a bank and see if I can short it or not short where banks are at, but it's just very interesting. And then they get bailed out and they have other lending facilities. There's always something you don't know that a bank is doing that you figure out like 6 months later that they are doing. For sake of time, let's transition now. We're talking about interest rates. The BRICS nations, you know, huge threat to the US dollar. A lot of people online saying the dollar's dead. You mentioned a second ago about rates and something me and my dad have actually, we're putting in our book. We've talked about it at length, but the concept that yes, we know the Fed is trying to help inflation and job growth. Those are two mandates, but overall their biggest job is to protect the number one asset of the United States, which is the US dollar. Yep. That is their number one job. And so one theory is that we are raising rates. Yes. For inflation, these other things, but to also show the world how strong the dollar is. And the dollar, the dollar index has been incredible. We've had record high inflation and the dollar is ripping. It's been doing incredible. All right. Again, compared to what?
Yep. And that's what I was just going to say.
compared to rubles, compared to UN, compared to Bitcoins, compared to the S&P, compared to gold, the dollar has done very, very well. It's up 11% over the last 2 years.
Yeah.
And so the one theory is that the Fed is going to continue rates high. And it's, the US might go into a recession or we might have some problems, but it's going to really decimate and hurt all these other economies on a compounded rate from degrees away, like you said, from the money printer. Yeah. I'm curious your thoughts, though, on right now, these currency wars that are taking place with BRICS, the US dollar and banks.
Okay, well, first of all, this may be a contrarian view. I have a feeling it is a contrarian view to yours. But for anybody listening or watching who is in fear that the BRICS are going to be a threat to the US or to the dollar, it's just not going to happen. Okay. Look, the BRICS are a bunch of dying countries. Okay, that are meeting and they will nibble at the edges a little bit, sure. But are they a real threat? Not even close. I mean, it's, you know, the BRICS have to change their name because now they want to add Saudi Arabia and the UAE, which, by the way, those would be the best countries in the basket probably to add, right? As much as they're messed up in their own way, but at least economically, they have oil. Okay. They've got a real commodity that the world wants. And, you know, so does Russia, but it can't sell it in an open market in any real way because of the sanctions. So I don't think that is a threat. I think the almighty dollar is going to be here a lot longer than many people think. I think the US is going to be the hegemon for a lot longer than people think. It's easy to criticize the US and say that all of these things are going to happen, but it's just incredibly unlikely. We have the most powerful military the human race has ever known. Okay. And like you said, the thing we are going to defend is the dollar. That is our number one product, is our dollar. And still, everybody wants to come here. Okay. And everybody's trading in the dollar. In developing countries, people keep dollars under their mattress because they know that's their version of gold. It's going to be the reserve currency for very long time.
I agree. I actually agree with you, which is contrary to most people. Most people, the U.S. is dead. I actually totally agree with you, but I'm a steel man on the other position of people that are listening.
Sure.
So I'll steel man the opposite. With adding these six new countries, global GDP from the BRICS nations is going to be about, I think, 31% of global GDP, which is about the same as the G7 countries. The massive difference is population. It is I think it's 40% of the world's population is in the BRICS nations. Yep. And these are emerging markets. These are emerging countries that are going to increase as they get access to internet like Starlink and access to blockchain, all these new technologies. They will produce more GDP and grow as emerging markets. What would you say to someone that says that to you?
I would say that is not going to happen. First of all, what makes anybody think these BRICS nations will actually get along with each other? First of all, they all have separate interests. I mean, look at the European Union. Okay, I was born in Europe and I study the EU a lot, right? You've got, what, 27 member nations now or something? They can't figure that out. That thing's going to fall apart. I mean, the EU, I don't hold out a lot of hope for it. I mean, the United States has managed to stick together even through its own big civil war for, what, 240 years. It's just a much more united thing than the BRICS. I mean, think of the massive cultural differences of these BRICS nations. Okay. You've got, now they want to add.
And geographical. They're spread over all the world.
It's insane. Yeah. Like, there's nothing bringing them together except their jealousy and hatred of the US. Okay. Yeah. Like, that's all they got. Okay. It's just not a threat. Okay. I don't know. And I'll make the disclaimer. I am not a geopolitical expert. Okay. But that's just what I think.
So central bank digital currency, is it happening or not, Jason?
Sadly, it is happening, and there's no way we're going to stop it. CBDCs are going to take over the world, and it's going to be very unfortunate because then they will be able to monitor and control our spending. A lot of people don't think of spending as a big form of freedom, but your ability to spend and trade the way you want is maybe one of the biggest forms of freedom. And if they can make money programmable, we are in for a lot of oppression. And this scares me greatly. This is very bad news for humanity because they can make your money not work at certain times of the day. They can make your money not work within more than a mile of your house. If there's a lockdown or a quarantine, maybe if they don't like what you post on Facebook, they make it so you can't buy internet access or cell phone with your yep. money, right? Your digital money that's tied to your phone. So this is a big concern, and CBDCs, they are definitely coming, and we need to do whatever we can to work outside of that system.
Thank you so much for listening. Please be sure to subscribe so that you don't miss any episodes. Be sure to check out the show's specific website and our general website, hartmanmedia.com, for appropriate disclaimers and terms of service. Remember that guest opinions are their own, and if you require specific legal or tax advice or advice in any other specialized area, please consult an appropriate professional. And we also very much appreciate you reviewing the show. Please go to iTunes or Stitcher Radio or whatever platform you're using and write a review for the show. We would very much appreciate that. And be sure to make it official and subscribe so you do not miss any episodes. We look forward to seeing you on the next episode.